Hey, good news. We're here today with Victoria Almazova to talk about formal DevSecOps. Join us. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show, where we'll be discussing the challenges you and our other tech-savvy customers have encountered. Together, we're going to be talking with experts to find out how they think about these problems, recommended tools and best practices, and tips they've had from years of experience that you can use. So today, we're really lucky because we have the chance to talk to Victoria Almazova, who is a senior security architect. And so in order to have this conversation, I think it's best that I go over to customer mode. So let me switch now. Hey, Victoria, thanks for taking time to talk to me. I could really use your help. So I was talking with my boss, and they are really, really interested in doing something called DevSecOps, which I've never heard of, and I don't really want to look like I don't know what I'm talking about. So could you just help me understand what DevSecOps is?
Yeah, I'm glad that you have asked. Let me ask you some questions. How you do the development today? I believe you're doing the DevOps, right?
Yeah, we've been a DevOps shop for a reasonable amount of time.
And how about the security part? So when you do the security, do you have any separate team and you check your application for the security vulnerabilities at the end of your development before going to the release?
Yeah, so we have a pretty good security team. They're really good. So what we usually do is what everybody else does. You know, we develop the code and we get the thing ready. And then when everything's ready, we turn to the security team to help us prove that it's secure. And they come in and do whatever they do, penetration tests or whatever. So I think this is the standard thing. We just at the end of the process, we make sure everything's secure.
Gotcha. And usually the penetration test and the security checks, they do take the time, correct? It takes like maybe 2 weeks or something like that?
Yeah, it can take a while because sometimes they get backed up for sure.
Yes. And this is where the DevSecOps comes in. So when we speak about the DevSecOps, it's all about getting the security practices in your DevOps environment and in your DevOps practices. That means that you are moving the security from the end of the state when you already have developed your solution and now you're waiting for your security team to the all the way to the beginning. So where you start to plan your application development, then you plan it, and when you develop it, build it and push it. In every single step, you are adding some small bits and pieces of the security checks.
So that sounds like a lot of work in the middle. Like, why is it important to do this?
Good point. Like you mentioned, for example, when you have done your development, now it's time for the security team. And usually it takes, like we discussed, 2 weeks or even a bit more. So that's one thing that doesn't go very well with the continuous delivery. And as well, how do you prioritize those findings? Because you are quite short in timing of the releasing your application, and usually you put these security findings in your backlog, and they may stay there forever, because obviously the prioritization is to bring the new functionality and every single sprint. So, and this is a reason why adding the small steps or the small security checks in every development step makes it more worth, because you spend, at some point it sounds like that you spend more time on integrating the security, but you fix the security findings before they even arrive to your production. Does it make sense?
Yeah, that makes total sense to me. So, okay, that's pretty convincing. Can you give me a sense of what's involved with this?
Of course. Let me show you the slide. So when we do the development, we have the different phases. Like we do the planning, then we develop the code, we push it to the source code repository where it gets compiled, and then it gets to the test environment, then to the production, and then it goes into the operation mode. So on every single step, what you can do, you can add some security practices, tools, and the processes. Like for example, when you plan your user stories, you as well may run the threat modeling, which will allow you to detect a potential security threats, which you can cover later with the security user stories and develop them in the same way as you do with the functionality, like to protect your application. And once you have developed your code, you commit it to the source code repository where you can run the static code analysis and as well check your dependency management, because we know a lot of the today's development is happening with the help of the third-party libraries, and we need to be sure that these ones are secure as well as your own code. Once we have checked our code and we go to the test environment, this is another place where you can add some additional security controls, like checking your infrastructure if you write it as a code. So in that way, you can add the security checks against your infrastructure. And then as well, you can do the security scanning. And in this time, you can do the dynamic security scanning. And after, when all the testing has been done and you have assured the quality and the security, you go into the production where you add on the top some other checks like the configuration checks. For example, your test environment may be different slightly from the production, and you may have missed some misconfigurations. And of course, in operations, in the same way like you do in the DevOps, it's quite crucial to focus on the monitoring and looking for the potential security threats from there. And as well, the blameless postmortems. These practices coming as from the DevOps, and they should be also emphasized in the security. Does it make sense for you, David?
Yeah, I totally get it. I guess the thing that I'm kind of struck about is there is it looks like there's a lot there to do, and it looks like there's definitely lots of things I could choose. Can you give me some senses like where to start and like how I would prioritize what I start on?
Yeah, it may sound very overwhelming, but what I would suggest to you is to look on your team setup. So what is the knowledge of the security in your team?
Well, I would say that, you know, our developers do have a sense of security, but they don't know nearly as much as the security people do. So, you know, some, I'd say, but not a ton.
Yes, in this particular case, if you can get your security team to work aside with you to help all of these things to get implemented, then I would start from the things that are quite close to the developers. And this is like the CI/CD pipeline, where you do the continuous integration and the continuous delivery. And this is where we could implement the things like the dependency management scanning. This will give the same seamless experience from the developer side, because you work with the pipelines and you know how to build them. So that transition would be quite helpful. So I would start with the CI/CD pipeline.
I like that idea a lot. I think I could really just use a little bit of help understanding what it means, you know, sort of like in the implementation and how we do this. I'm wondering if you would be willing to talk to me another time and we could sort of go over the tools aspects of this.
Of course, I will be happy.
Great. Well, let's do that. And so with that, let me switch back to host mode. Okay, back to being a host. And with that, I want to thank Victoria for helping me out as a customer. I want to thank you for watching this episode of the Azure Enablement Show. Don't forget to like, comment, share, and subscribe, and join us again to watch more of the Azure Enablement Show.